Thanks to the organisers for the invitation to speak here today. As Greg says, I'm going to talk about quantum effects in biological catalysis with a focus on hydrogen tunnelling and in particular dynamics that we particularly are interested in driving enzymatic hydrogen transfer reactions. And we sort of got in this field by mistake probably about 15 years ago. I'm a classical enzymologist by training, and we were looking at isotope effects for other reasons and started observing unusual properties of isotope effects, and that sort of sucked us into the quantum biology field about 15 years ago, and since we've been pushing on that and really haven't left that particular area. So I thought I'd kick off really from a classical enzymologist point of view, catalysis by enzymes, and if you consult Wikipedia, of course, what Wikipedia tells you is that catalysis really isn't any different from what happens in small molecule chemistry. And as enzymologists, what we've been doing really for the best part of 100 years is worrying about these sort of more classical issues here, the notion of induced fit, catalysis by bond strain, catalysis by proximity and orientation. Clearly, catalysis involving proton donors and acceptors, acid-base catalysis, electrostatic catalysis, and covalent catalysis. So if you look at the biochemical textbooks, of course, you'll see multiple examples of that type of reaction mechanism in terms of curly arrow sort of illustrations. I think more recently we've become more interested in quantum tunneling. Of course, electron tunneling has been known for a long time, but I think in biology the idea of hydrogen atom tunneling, whether it's H dot, H minus, H plus, the idea that that type of transfer could occur by quantum mechanical tunneling is a little bit more recent. And really, the field has hotted up, I think, in the last 10, 15 years from an initial point where I think H transfer by tunneling was seen as being rather esoteric in the field to a point now where I think there's widespread acceptance that tunneling is a major part of these reactions. So given that tunneling is now sort of widely acknowledged in the field, I think the current controversies at the moment are more on how dynamics might help assist in these particular reactions. So as I say, I'm an enzymologist, and we've over the years been using isotope effects as probes of hydrogen transfer, and I just thought I'd remind you how isotope effects can be useful in different areas of mechanistic enzymology. Clearly, we've got a situation here where we have more of a classical type transfer, here a cutting by tunneling underneath a classical transition state, and in an extreme case here, tunneling through a ground state type situation. Now, what isotope effects can do is report on tunneling. They can report indirectly, potentially, on dynamics, and that's where the real debate is at the moment. And I want to give you some new data that I think is convincing that dynamics are involved in these particular reactions. They can give information on couple motions, that's the coupling of neighboring atoms in the hydrogen transfer process. In a more classical sense, they can give information on the structure of transition states. And the sorts of experimental approaches that we've been using over the years are to study the temperature dependence of isotope effects, and that really is the gold standard in the field, I think, in terms of showing that quantum tunneling is part of the reaction. And from those temperature dependencies, we can infer that dynamics are also potentially important. We've also been developing pressure dependence work, looking at primary and secondary kinetic isotope effects. And what we've been trying to do is to sort of mix, if you like, experimental measurements, which is what my lab does, with insight from calculation theory through collaborations with sort of more theoretically inclined groups. And we've been doing that on both thermally activated enzymes and more recently on one or two sort of naturally dependent light activated enzymes that are available in literature. So this slide really just, I think, summarizes what the field has been seeing over the last 10, 12 years when we look at isotope effects associated with substrate carbon-hydrogen bond breakage. Typically, we can observe the temperature dependence here for carbon-hydrogen bond breakage. Here's the CD bond breakage. And this gives rise, typically, to at least experimentally temperature-independent kinetic isotope effects over this rather compressed temperature range. Of course, we can't access wider temperature ranges because we're using mixing strategies to initiate the enzyme reactions. Occasionally, we also see temperature-dependent kinetic isotope effects, typically in situations where either we've mutated a protein, we've somehow affected the geometry in the active site, and thereby affected the tunneling reaction, or perhaps when we're using non-conventional substrates, non-physiologically sort of relevant substrates that we might want to use in the laboratory. Even more infrequently, we can even see breakpoints in these sort of data, and this again sort of poses interesting questions. What's the origin, the mechanistic origin of that type of breakpoint? And that's something that we've been worrying about for a number of years. Now, early on, the question that was asked is, do we need a new physical description beyond transition state theory-type frameworks to explain these type of data? And there was a time, maybe in the last 7 or 8 years, where simple fibronic models have been used by experimentalists, ourselves included. These are very simple models, and I stress they're not accurate at all, but they have been useful in terms of at least semi-quantitatively or even qualitatively looking at reaction data. Regardless of the details of the model, I think conceptually this model helps us understand the hydrogen transfer process. So this is really an adapted Marcus-like model where we have our sort of reactant curve, our enzyme product curve as shown here, our collective reaction coordinate as shown in this direction, and then orthogonal to that, what we've shown here is the hydrogen transfer coordinate where we have our hydrogen nucleus here sat in the donor well. We need to transfer it to the acceptor well, and each of these planes maps onto the collective reaction coordinate here. And we can see in this position here, clearly we have a configuration that's not suitable for tunneling, but what we need to do through thermal activation along the collective reaction coordinate is to introduce degeneracy at this point here so that we can, in principle, at least adopt a tunneling-ready conformation. Now, there are various issues with this model. One is that this is a non-adiabatic description, of course, for proton transfer and hydride transfer. That's likely not to be an accurate description. There are other issues with this model. It's clearly very simplistic, but it does allow us to model trends that we see in data. And in terms of mapping our I-step effect data onto this model, in a situation where we can get tunneling from this position here in the absence of any sort of dynamics that, if you like, transiently narrow this tunneling barrier, which is the movement from plane A to plane B, then we can predict using this model that our temperature dependence that we measure in the laboratory ought to be essentially independent of temperature. In those situations where we get a strong temperature dependence, then this model will predict that, in fact, there's a requirement for what we call a promoting motion that very transiently has to, if you like, bring the donor and acceptor wells closer together to facilitate the quantum tunneling reaction through, if you like, a compressive motion, and I use that in a sort of in a loose way. And it's these promoting motions, really, that have been the source of heated debate, I think, in the literature and at meetings like this for a number of years in this particular field. So that's a conceptual model. I don't claim it's accurate, but it is useful. And again, this just illustrates how we can use I-step effect data in the laboratory and model it using the vibronic model. So there's the rate constant for the hydrogen transfer. It's related to a reorganizational term, a wave function overlap term, the Frank-Condon factor, and then this sort of contentious promoting motion. But of course, what we're doing in our experiments, unlike in the electron transfer field, we're using isotope effects, and many of these terms are isotope insensitive. So the KIE expressions are shown here, where in the first approximation, the Marcus reorganizational term is independent of the isotope effect, so that can cancel, if you like, in this expression. The electronic coupling sort of matrix element is wrapped up in the constant term here. And we can see that the KIE now can have a temperature dependence as a result of this promoting motion term, which is shown here. So there's the temperature dependence. So again, that's a sort of best approximation. Again, there are caveats in those particular arguments, but we can use that very simple expression to model temperature dependencies coming out of these data. Right, so some of the key questions and controversies in the field are listed here. And the most recent controversy is, really, does the temperature-dependent KIE actually report on dynamics? I think we're all fairly convinced in the field that we can use the temperature dependence to predict tunneling, regimes, but really can we infer the importance of dynamics in these reactions, i.e. are promoting motions really important in this type of hydrogen transfer reaction? We need to question the usefulness of vibronic models for H transfer. They're not accurate, but they're useful for modeling mutant series or for looking at reactions with different substrates. The issue of barrier compression, does it happen? What's the evidence for it? Those are important issues. And a problem that's been rattling around in the field for a long time is the question of catalytic contribution. If these dynamical effects in enzymes are important, and does a quantum process in the enzyme actually contribute to the catalytic contribution? That is, the rate of the reaction compared to the reaction that occurs in the absence of the enzyme. Is there really a contribution of tunneling to catalysis? I don't get too hung up on that because I think that's an idea I think that's almost impossible to test because you need model chemistry. My view is that really we need to focus on whether tunneling is actually important from a biological perspective. If tunneling increases, for example, the rate of a reaction by 10 to the 2 or 10 to the 3, that could be a lifesaver for a bacterium. And particularly given the ubiquitous nature of hydrogen transfer reactions, that may well be a very important aspect of the reaction. So these are all difficult questions, and like in all areas of science, it's important to keep an open mind and not to be dependent on experimental or theoretical approaches in isolation, but really to try and integrate all the approaches to get the best out of the science. We need to appreciate that each enzyme is different and therefore resist the temptation to generalize. And we need to explore these questions without hindrance from dogma. And if I'm honest, I think that's been a particular issue in our field in recent years. And we have to fight against prejudices and dogma that's already out there. Okay, so I'm going to talk about today hydrite tunneling in one of my sort of favorite families of enzymes. That's the old yellow enzyme, simple flavor proteins. I'm going to talk about the temperature dependence, first of all, of kinetic isotope effects, and to discuss whether these are consistent with tunneling and a need for promoting vibration as this contentious aspect. So the reactions I'm going to talk about are the reactions catalyzed by two enzymes, morphodone reductase and pentaerythritol tetranitrate reductase. This is the high explosive, PETN. And what these enzymes do is a common reaction cycle. Structurally, they're virtually identical. We did the crystal structures of these enzymes a number of years ago. We also did them in the presence of the reducing coenzyme, NADH. Well, it's an analog of the reducing enzyme, NADH4. This is a non-redox active form, but it tells us how that coenzyme is bound in the active site. The enzyme operates by binding NADH to form a Michaelis complex. We then get a hydrite transfer from NADH to NAD. Some wonderful spectral changes here. On a millisecond time scale, we can follow using stop flow spectroscopy. And what we've done is to focus very much on the reductive half reaction, the hydrite transfer from NADH to the flavin mononucleotide in the active site. To complete the catalytic cycle, we can then bind a second substrate to recover those electrons from the FMN to regenerate the free enzyme form. So again, this is the reaction. It's a simple hydrite transfer from the C4 position of the nicotinamide to the M5 of the flavin. That's the reductive half reaction. And there's the oxidative half reaction with a surrogate substrate in this particular case. And in the reduction process, the flavin chromophore goes from yellow to bleached. And that means we can use all these wonderful sort of simple enzymological tools to get the rate constants for these reactions. Stop flow spectroscopy is a function of pressure and temperature. We can probe primary, that's this position, and secondary isotope effects at this position. We can do the obvious things like probing the role of solvent dynamics by playing around with bulk solvent, and linking that then to these sort of more specialized approaches to gain more information on the reaction chemistry. I'm not going to dwell too much on the experimental methods other than to show that the quality of the data we get from these reactions unusually is very high for an enzyme system. This is a simple stop flow experiment, and you can see that we get very nice mono-exponential traces as a result of mixing the enzyme with NADH and following that reduction of the flavin. There's a conventional reaction there shown in black. There's a very small secondary isotope effect if we label at this position here, and you can very cleanly pull that out using the stop flow technique, and that's, I think, unusual for these enzyme systems. And then if we label at this position here, you can see now the primary isotope effect is quite large. That's the deuterium being transferred to the flavin. And then, should you want to, you can also do the double isotope effect. So the quality of the data we get from these systems is very high. And a long time ago now, we looked at the temperature dependence of these reactions with deuterated or dideuterated NADH. We found that the secondary kinetic isotope effect is shown here, 1.18, which is comfortably above the equilibrium isotope effect, and that's consistent with a tunneling reaction. The primary KIE is actually quite small. It's around about 5.7, but it's fully realized in the stop flow. It's not kinetically compromised by mixing with other aspects of the reaction cycle. And we can see that, in fact, that primary kinetic isotope effect has a very strong temperature dependence. So going back to our simple vibronic model, that would suggest not only that tunneling is happening, but also that promoting motions in some way are involved in this particular reaction. So we're inferring that. We don't have any direct evidence for it, and that's a criticism of the data, and that's something that we need to investigate further. And with colleagues back in Manchester, what we've been able to do is, at least computationally, study this reaction using ensemble average VTST-type methods with tunneling calculations. And I'm no expert in this area, but fortunately my colleagues are. And what we can do is study the transfer with conventional nicotinamide, monodeuterated in the primary or secondary positions, and the dideuterated. And we can calculate the free energy barriers for the classical reaction, the tunneling reaction. We can generate computational rate constants compared against experimental. And more importantly, we can generate KIE. So, of course, they don't ideally match up, but this is computation versus experiment. There's always going to be a little bit of wriggle room. But I think what we do take from this simulation is that our calculations here are consistent with this being a tunneling reaction. Okay, so I want to address this year's controversy in the field, I guess, in the sense that does the temperature dependence of the KIE report on dynamics? And there are various ideas in the literature at the moment discussing whether promoting motions are important in these reactions, or does the temperature dependence, for example, report on different conformational states? And we've thought we ought to try and address this particular issue because really the temperature dependence is the gold descriptor, really, of tunneling and potentially dynamics in these systems. So to do that, we've focused on this enzyme, PTNR, the explosive degrading enzyme. Fortunately, this enzyme works with both NADH and NADPH, and we showed a number of years ago that, in fact, the reductive half reaction with NADPH has a relatively strong temperature dependence on the KIE, whereas with NADH, it's temperature independent. So in the simplest sense, that would suggest that the NADPH chemistry potentially has a promoting motion associated with the reaction, whereas NADH has perhaps a less significant or indeed no promoting motion to help drive that hydrogen transfer reaction. Now, we've also been able to study these reactions as a function of pressure, and I'll talk about pressure in a moment, so I won't go into this data set other than to at least indicate that with NADPH we get this curve dependence on pressure, which again we interpret to indicate that in fact promoting motions may well be important in this reaction. The presence of the promoting motion, if indeed that's what it is, increases the hydride transfer rate constant to around about 33.5 per second, whereas in the absence of this inferred promoting motion, we're down at 2.0 per second. So if there is a motion, perhaps it's having a positive effect on the reaction chemistry. So how can we address that a little bit more carefully? Well, we took the lead from Vern Schramm's work, recently published on a different enzyme system, was looking at dynamics really in the transition state, and we've adopted that at the basic ideas. And we asked the question, can we sort of perturb the vibrational motion in PTNR without affecting the structure of the enzyme substrate complex? And we can do that by growing this enzyme on various stable isotope labeled media. So we might label in the presence of N15, C13, and with deuterium. So we've done that. We've looked at the NMR. We've got good NMR data for PTNR. We've been able to look at also these stably labeled forms. And we can show that the NMR confirms through temperature dependence of chemical shifts that in fact these labeled versions of the enzyme are essentially isostructural with the unlabeled form of the enzyme. That's the data shown here. So labeling doesn't affect the overall structure. So we infer that potential energy surface for nuclear motion is unaltered in the different enzyme forms, but that the frequencies of the protein vibrational modes will clearly be perturbed. We can show by mass spectrometry that we've got a mass increase of around about 9.8% for the heavy enzyme, and when we do N15 labeling alone, we've got 1.3% compared to the wild type. So all the sort of biochemical data is consistent with us getting very good incorporation of those stable isotopes. So what happens now when we look at the temperature dependence of these enzymes? Well, that's shown here on the right. On the left-hand panel, we've got the data with NADPH. Remember, that's a temperature-dependent KIE. Whereas on the right-hand side, we've got the data with NADH, which was essentially a temperature-independent KIE. The bottom line is that as we begin to incorporate stable isotopes into these compounds and we perturb the vibrational properties of the enzymes, we in fact pull out different temperature dependencies. And that's more pronounced in those systems where you have an inferred strong promoting motion, as we have with NADPH, but also this perturbation here in those systems where we have a temperature-independent KIE that's predominantly realized through the deuterated form of the data shown here rather than the protonated form. So if we map those temperature dependencies onto this type of plot here, we can see that we really end up with this continuum of effects on the temperature-dependent following substitution with heavy atoms. So our take-home sort of message from this is if we perturb the vibrational properties of the enzyme, we clearly perturb the temperature dependence of the KIE, and our conclusion, therefore, is that promoting motions are, in fact, sort of embedded, if you like, in that temperature-dependent kinetic isotope effect data. So we think this is fairly persuasive evidence that, indeed, fast motions are reported on by the temperature dependence of KIEs. So here's the conclusions from that simple experiment. A change in frequency of the vibrational modes of the protein alters the temperature dependence. We have this continuum of effects. Temperature-independent KIEs are also affected by heavy atom labeling, suggesting that, in fact, heavy atom labeling is a more sensitive way of pulling out dynamics than is obtained by just doing standalone temperature-dependent studies. The strongly T-dependent KIEs probably indicate strong coupling to promoting motions. The weaker KIEs also indicate less dependence on strong promoting motions, but there's still some fast motion involved in the chemistry. So we think KIEs and their temperature dependence are useful probes of tunneling and indeed dynamics, and that heavy atom labeling is a sensitive method to probe dynamics. And I think actually what the data does show, probably for the first time, is this issue of cause and effect. In that, you know, as we change the vibrational properties of the enzyme, we change the reaction chemistry. So that links formally the idea that vibrational modes are somehow linked to the reaction coordinate. Okay, so what I'd like to do now is to go back to some slightly older work and show you how we've used pressure dependence as a probe of these fast motions. And again, we're going back now to a more inferred situation where we can look at the pressure dependence and try and learn something about the properties of these putative promoting motions, or certainly more putative before we did the heavy atom labeling experiment. So again, this is the active site of the enzyme. There's the flavin. What I've done here now is to show how that nicotinamide cofactor is bound over the flavin. And you can see this pi-pi stacking. That gives rise to a wonderful charge transfer complex. And indeed, when we substitute NADH for the redox inert, but essentially isostructural analog, not quite isostructural, but very close, NADH4, we get this similar pi-pi stacking. We can do simple pressure dependence spectroscopy of this charge transfer band to ask the question, when we ramp up the pressure, do we bring that nicotinamide and flavin closer together, and does that somehow enhance the charge transfer band? Or to cut a long story short, that is exactly what we do see. So here's the free enzyme, here's the transiently trapped NADH oxidized enzyme charge transfer band in red, here's the corresponding NADH4 transient here. We can now do pressure spectroscopy on that band, and we can show that that grows in reversibly as we ramp up and down the pressure. That's sort of consistent with maybe pressure somehow bringing the nicotinamide and the flavin close together and enhancing that charge transfer band. Again, with colleagues in Manchester, we've done MD simulations of that complex at different pressures at 1 bar, 1 kilobar, and 2 kilobar. And if you sort of bin the distances between donor acceptor across different enzyme substrates complexes coming out of those simulations, we can show that the macroscopic barrier here begins to shorten as we ramp up the pressure. So all this is consistent with pressure somehow modulating the barrier between the nicotinamide and the flavin. So this is what we're proposing, at least for this enzyme, and this is not consistent for all enzymes. We have another recently published study where pressure doesn't respond in this particular way. But what we're suggesting here is that this charge transfer complex, as you ramp up the pressure, reduces the distance. We can modulate the barrier properties here. And we're asking the question, therefore, is this a mimic, if you like, of what happens during catalysis when we're reducing the flavin with conventional NADH? Can we get this type of barrier compression also happening? These are the key questions we want to ask. What's the extent of compression? Does it facilitate the reaction chemistry? Is transfer still predominantly by tunneling if we compress the barrier, or is there an element of over the barrier through the classical transition state going to be switched on? And, of course, we'd like to know what's the catalytic advantage, if any, of this compression. So to try and answer these issues, turn the time clock back a little further. In 2007, it was actually Sam Hay, who sat in the audience, did a whole range of pressure-dependent isotope effect measurements on this particular enzyme and carried out some semi-quantitative modeling using the vibronic model to try and understand a little bit in a little bit more detail as to how pressure might mimic these promoting motions. So here's the beast. This is the variable pressure stop flow that's sat in my group. It's a pretty hideous instrument to use. Sam can give you the details on that. I can't. But basically, again, we can, through rapid mixing, follow the flavin reduction step here. And you can show here, as we ramp up the pressure, that the hydride transfer chemistry is affected. So, you know, here's a fast rate here that occurs at high pressure. Here's a low rate that occurs at low pressure. The binding reaction is not affected by pressure. That's shown by this data here. So we are specifically homing in on the hydride transfer chemistry. To cut a long story short, what Sam did was to look at, first of all, the temperature dependence and indeed the pressure dependence of these hydride transfer rates, and also with the corresponding deuterated nicotinamide, and plotted the variation in KIE as a function of pressure and as a function of temperature. And the take-home message from this data, and it's a lot of data, is that the temperature dependence is effectively unchanged across the pressure range. But as we ramp up the pressure, we can see, first of all, that the rate of hydride transfer goes up, as you might expect if we narrow in the barrier. But also, and this is what puzzled us for a while, the KIE also increases. Now, if you shorten the distance between two wells, theory would tell you that, in fact, you'd expect the opposite. You'd expect the KIE to fall, and that's sort of shown on this diagram here, where R is the distance, there's the KIE, and there's the relative rate. So as we effectively shorten the distance down here, the rate would go up, but you'd expect the KIE to fall, and that's really just simply because of the shape of the wave functions for the hydrogen and deuterium, the fact that you're affecting more so the deuterium overlap than you are the protium overlap. So that had us confused for a while until Sam did some, again, sort of simple sort of vibronic modeling type experiments. This again just reminds you of the rate equation and the KIE terms that come out of that particular model. We made some approximations in doing this modeling. There's no isotope dependence on the Marcus reorganizational terms, so that disappears in the KIE expression. And we assumed that the pressure-sensitive step was predominantly going to be found on this promoting motion step, which we can be modeled as a sort of harmonic oscillator, if you like, where we're sort of distance sampling as we sort of compress and relax the distance between the two wells. So this is the result of the modeling, and I don't want to sort of dwell on this too much other than to say that what Sam did was to create simulated plots of KIE versus the force constant for this promoting motion at different R0 equilibrium separations shown here. And then mapped onto that are experimental data shown here. We knew the temperature dependence didn't change as a function of pressure, that's shown here. And then what we can begin to suggest is that the effective pressure here is to reduce R naught, and it's quite a significant reduction in R naught. And again, there are caveats in the modeling that explain that, one being that we treat the wave functions as essentially not as a Morse potential, but as a harmonic potential. And what he was able to show is that you can reduce R naught as we ramp up the pressure, but to do that, to get the KIE to also rise, which is consistent with our experimental data, we also have to get the force constant to increase as the pressure is reduced. And again, that's intuitive, I think. If you reduce the distance between the donor acceptor, then the force constant, perhaps, you would expect to increase. So the KI dependence, therefore, is not only just dependent on distance, which is shown on this plot. As we reduce the distance, the KIE falls, but counteracting that is the idea that as the distance gets shorter, the force constant increases, and that works in the opposite direction. So again, this is all sort of simple numerical modeling based on that vibronic model. But essentially, what we can conclude here is that the effective wave function, that is a wave function integrated over the gating coordinate, that changes shape, essentially narrowing, as shown here, as the distance decreases, i.e. as we increase the pressure. So all this shows consistency. It doesn't prove. It shows consistency we can model promoting modes reasonably successful using this sort of data. It clearly doesn't show that promoting modes are important. Since then, we've, again, with computational colleagues in Manchester, try to get a little bit more information on these putative compressive modes, again by carrying out spectral density analysis of MD simulations. And the key peaks to point out here are the ones at this end of the analysis here, because clearly the magnitude of the spectral density is dependent on the amplitude and the frequency squared. So these peaks here, the three shown here, are the sort of predominant peaks that we're interested in. And what colleagues did in Manchester was to carry out digital filtering and to show, to focus really just on the 70 to 220 wave number regime and show this symmetrical sort of relationship, if you like, between the principal component for this 70 to 220 wave number motion and the distance between the nicotinamide C4 and M5 position. And in fact, going one step further, you can actually show that, in fact, predominantly the motion arises mainly from the nicotinamide coenzyme ring here, not from the flavin, and the frequencies we get out of that are consistent with MS2 calculations on free nicotinamide, which come out to be around about 82 wave numbers. So again, there's all this sort of indirect data that would suggest that promoting motions are important in this particular reaction. Taking that analysis one step further, we've refined the vibronic modeling of our experimental data now by including a Morse potential, by taking out the effective force constant that comes out of those MD simulations, frequencies and the force constant here. And actually we can begin to reproduce, how solid this is I think is up for debate, but we can begin to reproduce the experimental data, map it onto the sort of more theoretical simulations that come out of the MD work. And in fact, the changes in R naught now as we ramp up the pressure are more realistic, 1.07 to 0.85. The KIE is in the right sort of ballpark region for what we see experimentally, and indeed the increase in rate constant as we ramp up the pressure from the simulation work is in fact mapping very nicely onto our experimental data. So again, I think you've got to take this data holistically. You've got to sort of look at it in the context of everything that we've done on these enzymes, and none of it on its own stands alone and says that promoting motions are important, but I think what we can at least show is that all these different experimental approaches seem to be coming to a sort of common conclusion that indeed motions along the reaction coordinate are in fact important. So this is a more standard site-directed mutagenesis experiment. This is now going back to morphinone reductase, where again there's a promoting motion thought to be involved. There's the nicotinamide, there's the flavin. We've targeted now two or three residues in the active site and used this charge transfer band as a way of indirectly measuring, if you like, the distance between the NADH and the flavin. And if we do that, again, we can qualitatively show that as we begin to make mutations, there's the charge transfer band absorption, there's the wild type. If we make this mutation, the CT band goes down, the inference being we slightly increase the distance. Whereas we make these mutations here, then you can see the CT band goes up. And that perhaps indicates that we've in fact pushed the nicotinamide even closer to the flavin, as shown here. And that's also consistent with measured secondary kinetic isotope effects, which I don't have time to go into today, but that there is a consistency there with the distance effects. Modeling all that against the vibronic modeling, qualitatively we can show that R0 goes up or goes down in this predictable way. The force constant goes down and up again in a predictable way. And indeed the temperature dependence of the kinetics that we observe are consistent with the fact that as you increase the distance, you need more distance sampling so that you can compress the barrier to allow the H transfer to occur. And if you decrease the distance, the force constant becomes stiffer and you have less distance sampling that occurs. So again, taken in isolation, not unequivocal evidence, but taken with everything else that we've done, I think is reasonably persuasive that these compressive motions are important. I'm going to finish really just by sort of giving a pointer to the future. How do we detect compressive motion directly? Well, I showed you that stable isotope effect experiment. I think that at least tells us that fast motions are somehow coupled to the reaction coordinate, but we have no idea how that really happens, and that's the challenge for us as we move forward. All these, of course, kick out in the sort of terahertz region of the spectrum, and that makes spectroscopy and pump probe type studies a complete nightmare. And indeed, when the UK government was a little sort of richer than perhaps it is now, there were national facilities being developed for terahertz fourth generation light sources. This is the prototype that was built at Alice, and we were sort of loosely involved with this at that stage, but then the bottom dropped out of the UK economy and all that was put on hold. But you know, in retrospect, looking to do pump probe experiments with terahertz spectroscopy is not really a starter. So rather than looking in the frequency domain, we're looking at the time sort of area. And like others discussed yesterday, who are much more advanced in this area than we are, we've decided that we need to make a bit of a leap into femtosecond spectroscopy, in an attempt to look at some of these compressive motions by ultrafast spectroscopy. Now, I'm no expert in femtosecond spectroscopy. We've only been playing this game for the best part of a year. We've essentially built our kit and started making our first measurements. And what I put up here might be perceived by some of the audience as being relatively naive, but this is essentially where we're going, and any feedback on this we will be happy to take. But essentially, again, we can pre-assemble our NADH4 FMN enzyme complex, and using femtosecond pump probe spectroscopy, get that into the excited state, then try and follow then the decay back to the ground state. Well, that's our spectrometer that I'm sure you're not interested in. And then look at the recovery to the ground state, as shown here. We started these experiments with wild types and mutants, and in fact already we're seeing differences in the lifetimes of the excited state as we vary the mutations. There's some sort of rather weak correlation that we're seeing at the moment with distance and lifetimes. Whether that means anything, I'm not sure. But the next stage really is to try and start looking for sort of structure within these decay curves and to see whether we can get direct evidence in some form for promoting motions. So there's the summary. Old yellow enzymes are amenable to studies of tunneling. Temperature-dependent KIs and secondary KIs are consistent with tunneling reactions. We've used combined pressure and temperature studies, again, to show these tunneling effects. And I think now we've got a better idea that dynamics are somehow involved in this particular process. And in the future, we'll be working with physics colleagues to try and get direct spectroscopy outputs that perhaps take us in that particular direction. And thanks for your patience, and that's where I'll finish. Other than to thank those, and particularly Sam, who's in the audience, who has driven quite a lot of this stuff, and also Chris Podney, who's somewhere on here, who's been very much involved in much of that work. Thank you.